तो से सारियां की मेरी तरफों नमस्ते। आज अस परतीय जुड़े दे हैं साडे कनेक्टिंग टू द रूट्स इतिहास दे पन्ने। आज ता साडा टॉपिक है प्राइम मिनिस्टर शेख अब्दुल्ला। ओवर टू सर हरबंस सिंह संभ्याल जी।
थैंक यू वेरी मच। नमस्कार सभी लोगों को। इट हैज बीन अ लॉन्ग गैप आई प्रिज्यूम, एंड लेट अस पिक अप आवर थ्रेड्स अगेन। वी बिगिन टुडे विद अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फेज, एंड आई वांट टू मेक टू स्टेटमेंट्स बिफोर आई कम टू द सब्जेक्ट। नंबर वन, देर आर टू एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ दिस प्रॉब्लम। वन इज द जम्मू एंड कश्मीर प्रॉब्लम, that is between the two regions. That is one problem. The other problem is the Kashmir problem. Kashmir problem is specific to the people of Kashmir. There is history behind it, culture behind it, certain grievances, certain xenophobic ideas. All of them get mixed up in making this problem. Another statement which I would like to make is that I might be making some judgments today on certain issues. I usually avoid. I don't belong to any political party. I have no intention of promoting any of the political parties. My primary interest is only with the well-being of Jammu and the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Having said that, I take you back to 2nd November 1947. That was the day when Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru visited Srinagar for the first time after the accession. A meeting was held at Lal Chowk. Sheikh Abdullah had organized a huge rally. It appeared, as the accounts say, that as if the whole of Srinagar was there. And after making many statements, Sheikh Abdullah turned to Jawaharlal Nehru and recited a couplet which was composed by Amir Khusro for his Aulia Nizamuddin. The couplet goes like this: Man tu shudam tu man shudhi, man tum shudan tu jan shudhi, takas na goyad badazi, man digaram tu digari. I am you and you are me. It is my body, but your soul in it. So that no one from now onwards can say that I am different and you are different. Now, this was almost blasphemy. If we had he been living in today's Pakistan, Amir Khusro wouldn't have seen the light of the day after having made this statement. But the purpose was, he was expressing his love, his affection, his devotion, his affinity to Hazrat Nizamuddin. Now, the same kind of affinity, devotion, and a statement was made by Sheikh Abdullah to Jawaharlal Nehru in the presence of a large audience. It was a statement affirming the close relationship between the two. One a Kashmiri Muslim, the other a Kashmiri Brahmin. It was a statement affirming faith in the composite culture of Kashmir, what many people like to call Kashmirian. That was a statement made on 2nd November 1947. This statement would get unraveled during the next 3 or 4 years. By 1953, this statement would be lying in tatters. How that happened, that is the subject matter of our discourse today. Yuvraj Karan Singh, he reached Srinagar after he had been appointed regent. And the Maharaja had left for Bombay. But there were early signs of what was lying ahead in the future for the state and for the people. And more importantly, for Jawaharlal Nehru and the leadership in Delhi. On April 14, 1949, even before the Maharaja had been exiled, even before Yuvraj had become the regent, on 14th April 1949, Sheikh Abdullah, as Prime Minister, newly appointed Prime Minister, met two journalists, English journalists, Michael Davidson and Ward Price. They were representing Observer and the Scotsman. He gave an interview regarding the whole situation of Kashmir, the dispute, what were his dreams, what the people expected, and what the reality was. But worryingly for the country, Prime Minister Sheikh Abdullah said, accession on either side cannot bring peace. We want to live in friendship with both dominions. Perhaps a middle path between them with economic cooperation with each will be the only way of doing it. But an independent Kashmir must be guaranteed not only by India and Pakistan, but also by USA, Britain, and other members of United Nations. So the first salvo had been fired. The first move had been made by Sheikh Abdullah. He had opened his card, and this statement, when it reached Delhi, naturally, it created a lot of worry. Now, I have mentioned what happened after that in my book, Karan Singh, page 27. On page 27, if those of you who have that book, they will find that
जरा वो वीडियो लाना
मुझे पटेल रोड टू गोपाला स्वामी एंगर यू हैव प्रोबेबली सीन द इंटरव्यू बाय शेख साहब टू माइकल डेविडसन व्हिच वाज पब्लिश्ड इन स्कॉट्समैन ऑफ April 14, 1949 अ वेहेमेंट एक्सपोनेंट ऑफ एक्सेशन टू इंडिया seems to have been converted to an independent Kashmir. He wants absentee landlords, most of whom have gone to Pakistan, to be expropriated. At the same time, he has got, according to the information brought here by Sethi of the Agriculture Minister, large tracts of valuable irrigated lands vacant, lest non-Muslims should settle down on them. And this is at a time when elsewhere we are asking for every inch of land to be cultivated. Now we see that these are the different priorities. The first priority for the government of India at that time was that there was a huge influx of refugees. And those refugees, they needed to be fed. And India was in no position to produce that much of food grain to feed them. So they were trying to find out ways and means of cultivating each and every inch of the land. And here was Sheikh Abdullah, who did not even allow those Hindu Kashmiris, Sikh Kashmiris, who had migrated from Pakistan-occupied Kashmir to this part, they were not allowed to settle in Kashmir. They were pushed down to Jammu. This was a dangerous trend. It indicated to some kind of a long-term plan which would not have been to the liking of Government of India. When Iyengar got this letter, he also responded. He said, "My attention was drawn to the comments of this interview earlier in the day. It is a more astonishing performance. Kachru, who is going to Kashmir tomorrow, has just been to see me, and I am sending a message through him to Sheikh Abdullah. I have asked him to tell the letter that I condemn the Sheikh's action and that I feel that what he has told Michael Davidson and what the letter has published will have the most serious and mischievous consequences." Iyengar also said that he was sending Kachru. Kachru was private secretary to Jawaharlal Nehru. He was sending him to Kashmir to meet Sheikh Abdullah, inform him the concern of the Government of India, and to ask him to contradict this statement. Kachru duly went there, but Kachru was hardly treated with respect by Sheikh Abdullah. And when Kachru pointed out that this is what the Government of India would like you to do, that contradict this statement, withdraw this statement, he flatly refused. He said that there is nothing wrong in that. It is just a loud thinking. I was doing some loud thinking that what are the options before Kashmir, and this doesn't mean anything. But in the circumstances that existed then, it did mean a lot. Why he refused to contradict it or retract it, contradiction would have been difficult. He would have had to retract the statement. He did not do that. Sheikh Abdullah as a leader was very soon spotted as a person who was intolerant, who barely tolerated any dissent. Anyone who dissented with him, he was thrown out of the party. And if he was from Jammu, the possibility is that he would either land up in jail or out of the state. 49 passed like this, and 50 arrived. Now what happens is that any dictator, authoritarian leader, he has a terrible flaw. The flaw is that he compulsively makes grand gestures. He looks out for occasions, and on those occasions, he makes some grand gesture to consolidate his hold over his following. Now, this is a trend that is everywhere. All authoritarian leaders in the world, they have been doing that for ages. What we say, a populist move, a populist announcement, it's the same thing. Populist announcements are made by authoritarian leaders. And when they make it during a rally, political rally, or a political function, that gives a very clear signal that the purpose of that statement is political. July 13th was approaching of 1950. July 13th, you will remember, is the day when there was communal rioting in Srinagar, and it was followed by the police action in which 13 Kashmiris were killed. National Conference has been ever since marking that day as a Martyrs' Day. Martyrs' Day, again, 1950 was a very important day. 48, 49, it was the Kashmiris had achieved their goal. So he wanted to make a grand gesture on that occasion. And he decided to introduce land reforms. So he wrote a letter to the regent that he should issue a proclamation regarding the land reforms, in which the jagirdari is abolished and landlordism is abolished without any compensation. And then the nitty-gritty of the whole thing that came later, that the land would be redistributed among the landless. Yuvraj replied, he knew that the most affected people would be the Dogras of Jammu, specifically the Rajputs. They held their jagirs in Kashmir. They held most of the land in Jammu. And in Jammu, everybody knows that there are only two regions which are productive. One is the Arespura, and the other is what the old revenue records would say, Chandgram, near Kathua. I never knew before this study that Chandgram was such an important place. Because Kathua, most of the Kathua is barren, is hilly, is water deficient. But this part, which falls from Kathua city onwards towards Pakistan, that is the productive land. So these are the only two productive areas. The rest is dependent upon little bit of rain. It's very difficult to cultivate the terrain. And hence, even if people held land, they were not very prosperous. That is the reason everybody in Kandy area had to look for employment in the army, whether Indian army or the state forces. Because land never sustained any of them. So Yuvraj replied that this is a serious issue. It has implications not only in the state, where it does have very serious implications, because a large number of people, they would be deprived of whatever little land they have. But more importantly, in the rest of the country is already seized of this problem of zamindari. All the states of the country, they were struggling with how to deal with zamindari, the tenants, and the landless laborers. How socio-economic justice can be given in a republic? That challenge, everybody knew there was a challenge. But since the rest of the country was working democratically, it was building a consensus. Then there was Vinoba Bhave, Sant Vinoba Bhave, who launched his Bhudan movement. That was also part of ameliorating this situation. But Sheikh Abdullah decided that no, he doesn't have the patience. He is not going to wait to build consensus in the state for this new act. It must be implemented under the proclamation of the regent. Yuvraj duly informed the government of India that this is the situation. The government of India advised him to write back that this is a serious matter of far-reaching consequences. Therefore, more discussion needs to take place, particularly with the government of India as well. When Sheikh Abdullah read this, he lost his temper and he wrote back warning Yuvraj that he was probably forgetting the constitutional limitations upon him. Now, what were the constitutional limitations? The constitutional limitations were that according to the proclamation of 5th March 1948 signed by Maharaja Hari Singh, a prime minister had been appointed and Maharaja had given him all the power to exercise his powers. Maharaja had become a nominal head, a constitutional head, more like the king or the queen of Great Britain. Yuvraj replied that, yes, I do know my limitations. But he insisted that the state has surrendered only 3 subjects to the government of India. And land reforms is not one of the subjects that has been surrendered to the government of India. And hence, government of India has no say in it. And we need not consult with the government of India. Now, this was the situation. Yuvraj did not sign the proclamation, but Sheikh Abdullah went ahead and on 13th of July, he announced the reforms. He announced the reforms which he had no power to do. Had the Yuvraj signed the proclamation, they would have been legal. They have been perfectly all right. But the Yuvraj had not signed it, and hence, properly speaking, his announcement was null and void. But he announced, and the administration belonged to him, and the work started going ahead of throwing out the jagirdars and appropriating the land, the process of evaluating that who has surplus land, etc. Now, this was something which came as a rude shock to both the Yuvraj as well as Sheikh Abdullah. Sheikh Abdullah had never expected that Yuvraj would be thinking independently and doing anything which is against his wishes or desires. He probably believed that having the experience of the fate of his father, he would hesitate from annoying Sheikh Abdullah. But this was not the first time that Yuvraj had annoyed him. He had annoyed him in 1949. Soon after his arrival, in Srinagar. It was summer, and soon after, the festival of goddess Kheer Bhavani was to take place. Now the pandits, they were not feeling very easy with the whole change that had taken place, occurred in the state. They were very shaky, they were insecure, and under the leadership of a retired accountant general, Pandit Parmanand, they approached Karan Singh and invited him for the Kheer Bhavani festival. He readily agreed. For the first time, as an independent person, he was taking some action which he thought was good for the people. He was convinced that the Hindus of the valley, they were feeling insecure, and his going out and meeting them would assure them of their safety and security in the state. Now, so no sooner had Sheikh Abdullah come to know that Yuvraj is going to Kheer Bhavani, he sent him a message that he should not be going there. That it would be a wrong message. You know, what is the percentage of Kashmiri Pandits there at that time? And look at the massive majority that the Muslims have. If they were to feel insecure because some sentiment of the minority community was respected, how would that send a wrong signal? Only Sheikh Abdullah knew and nobody else. But Karan Singh decided that it would be dishonorable for him to go back on his word. He had promised and he would keep his promise. So he went to Kheer Bhavani. At Kheer Bhavani, something happened which gave jitters to Sheikh Abdullah. He was given a rousing reception by the Kashmiri Pandits. The elderly women, they kissed his forehead, they embraced him, and the crowd chanted the slogans of Dogra Raj Zindabad. Now this is understandable. Kashmiri Pandits have always been at the wrong end of the stick. It was only during the Dogra rule that they had lived in a secure life for 100 years. Now that security was threatened, and when they found the symbol of their security, the Yuvraj of the Dogra dynasty, they were naturally very pleased and happy. This news, naturally, it was to reach Sheikh Abdullah, and he had already added a black mark when this thing happened, the land reform issue came up. Now, land reform issue was extremely, I would say, difficult for everyone. This is, the land was, no one was allowed to have more than 182 canals of land. And it was redistributed wherever it could be. Now, I would like to say one thing. There is only one person who has made an exhaustive study of the land reforms of Kashmir. I do not know, I am not at least aware, if anyone has done the same kind of study in Jammu also. This study, which was done in Kashmir, was by an American professor by the name of David Thorner, a professor at the University of Pennsylvania. And I must add, though it is not relevant to our subject today, that he had been forced to flee from USA during the McCarthy period, when all supposedly liberal trade unionist or leftist people were either put in jail or driven out of USA. David Thorner had come to India. He lived here, he worked here, and he wrote a book. And the first study which he did on land reforms was published in the Economic Weekly. The land reforms, as I said, the purpose was to win the support of the backward classes in Jammu. Because Kashmir, of course, it's easy that in Kashmir, the support would be there. There was a problem in Jammu. The backward classes, when they got their land, it was easy for them to support Sheikh Abdullah. As I said, 182 canals was the maximum, that is 22.75 acres. Jagirs, they were abolished. Surplus land transferred to the tillers. Surplus not owned by anyone, appropriated by the state, and then redistributed. The same land to other people. Now the total impact was, according to Thorner, 9,000 landowners were dispossessed of 45 lakh acres of land. This surplus land was transferred to landless tillers, free from any encumbrance. Now, nobody should have any grudge on this count. It's okay. But the problem was that this was economically unsustainable. And this is the study which David Thorner did. His study was published, as I said, in Economic Weekly. And what he noticed was that there were debt conciliation boards. Farmers usually are in debt. So debt conciliation boards were constituted. But what he saw in Kashmir was that there was hardly any reconciliation. There was no process of conciliation there. There were debt cancellation boards, lock, stock and barrel, without going into the merit of the debt or the extent of the debt. All debt was cancelled. He then visited a village of 1,800 people, and he found that of the 1,800 families there, only 10 families had sustainable landholding. Redistribution was categorized. In many cases, former tenants got the same land, but a large number of the people were less fortunate. Why was that? It was because the faulty method through which the the redistribution of land had taken place. The fact of agriculture, not only of Kashmir, but the Indian agriculture in general, is that 2 acres of land does not sustain a family. And in Kashmir, the redistribution did not give more than 2 acres of land to anyone. And a large number of them got either quarter of an acre or half an acre of land. It was distributed, but it only gives the satisfaction that they have some land in their name, but you could not live on it. Corruption was rampant in this redistribution. The village he visited, a Halka Pradhan of National Conference, was accompanying a Patwari. Now, it's an age-old problem, not only in Jammu and Kashmir, but all over the country, that there is always a nexus between the government servants and the political leaders, whoever has the power. Now the Patwaris would do what the Halka Pradhan was telling him to do. In other words, the land distribution had become a tool in the hands of National Conference. Halka Pradhan, he confessed to Professor Thorner that land had been unfairly distributed among the well-to-do tenants of absentee landlords or landless laborers. A land which should have been gone to the landless laborers was allocated to the former tenants, though they had more land. The reality of Indian agriculture is that a person may have 5 or 10 acres of land, but there are other people in the village who hardly have an acre or 2 acres of land and which are adjoining to each other, adjacent to each other. So they usually give it on contract basis for the other person to cultivate. So a person who has 5 or 10 acres of land in his name, he is actually cultivating 15 or 20 acres of land. So obviously, his income is much more. But the person who has that 1 acre or 2 acres of land, he gets insufficient land. Thorner also found that among the beneficiaries, there was a contractor, a brick kiln owner, and a trader who already possessed more than the ceiling. In other words, the land reforms were negated right at the beginning. In another village of 200 families, Professor Thorner found only 20 could support their families from the produce of their land. 25 families were those who were unable to pay the land revenue. So how do they pay the land revenue? They ask the Halka Pradhan to help them. So Halka Pradhan gives them the money to pay the land revenue so that they keep on holding that land. But he will charge interest. So the farmer goes into deeper debt. There were people who had 11 acres of land, but were allotted additional 6 acres simply because they were also tenants of an absentee landlord. So this was the reality of the land reforms. And this is what Sheikh Abdullah wanted to do with great fanfare. Now we come down to Sheikh Abdullah as a leader. One of his associates was the late Balraj Puri. He was basically a socialist, you can say a leftist, a social worker, political worker, thinker, writer. Now he says the problem in JNK was that there was no distinction between the party and the administration. There were examples. He gave a letter written by the Wazir-e-Wazarat of Doda district. In his official capacity, he is removing the office bearers of National Conference and appointing new office bearers for that district. Now, how can somebody, a government official, be a political activist, or a political activist be a government official? But this is how things were. This is what was happening. Balraj Puri brought this to the notice of Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru also. But Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, he made it very clear to him, according to Balraj Puri, that the whole Kashmir policy of Government of India revolves around Sheikh Abdullah. And therefore, nothing has to be done, nothing can be done which might annoy him. So things continued like that. What happened in Kashmir because of the political interference? Professor David Thorner, he had discovered that. And Kashmir is a place where National Conference had a heavy presence. In Jammu, it hardly had any presence. So nobody knew the persons which were being appointed. And those persons had the power of even arresting and punishing a person who, in their opinion, was guilty of a crime. So a state where a proper judicial process had been established by the Maharaja was demolished, and its place, a system which the world had seen in communist Russia, Soviet Union, where a political worker is attached to every department of the government, where a political agent is present in every battalion of the army, and who can overrule the CEO also. That kind of a situation had been created in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. So this thing, which began with the announcement of the land reforms, it snowballed. It snowballed to a situation where it was imperative to tell Sheikh Abdullah that these are massive reforms, these are revolutionary reforms, and they cannot be taken without a proper forum being there. And the proper forum is a legislative assembly. Only a legislative assembly can make a law of such huge dimension and importance. He, who had been the Prime Minister from 5th March 1948, who had been appointed Prime Minister on the condition that he will take steps to convene a legislative, a constituent assembly. He had taken no step to constitute that assembly. But on the other hand, he was taking momentous decisions, dismantling the whole system, destroying the lives of thousands of people, psychologically creating a handicapped society of Jammu without any sanction of law. So the first step had to be that there should be a constituent assembly. So the move was first made. Sheikh Abdullah asked Yuvraj to sign a proclamation so that he could undertake the process of convening the constituent assembly. But this was a massive decision. The Yuvraj could not have taken such a decision on his own. Maharaja Hari Singh was still the ruler of the state. His consent was essential in this subject. So Yuvraj duly informed him that I cannot issue this proclamation. This proclamation has to be issued by the Maharaja. And already there were discussions going on between Delhi and the state and the Maharaja, Delhi and the Maharaja, regarding the proclamation. And Maharaja had explicitly told Yuvraj not to sign the proclamation till he gives the green signal. So Yuvraj was bound by the Maharaja. Maharaja was still the Maharaja. He was the ruler. Yuvraj was only exercising authority on his behalf. Now, when he informed Sheikh Abdullah, he obviously did not like it. In fact, he got angry. And a few days after that, he was in Jammu, in Panthal, and he addressed a rally mostly of those landless laborers who had been allotted land, or tenants who had been given the right to the land which they had been tilling. And in that rally, he made a very unfair and public attack on Yuvraj Karan Singh. He warned him that he should desist from consulting people who are reactionary, who are Kamdal. And that if he doesn't desist from that act, then he will also meet the same fate which his father met, and he will not be living in the state. राजे और महाराजाओं का जमाना निकल गया है. He made it very clear कि राजे और महाराजे जहां पर बचे हुए हैं वो भी जो है जनता की कृपा से बचे हुए. So you have to do what I'm telling you. But even more outrageously, what he did was that he again launched an attack on Maharaja. He once again brought up the issue के महाराजा ने जो है महाराजा और महारानी ने इनके इशारे पर जो है जम्मू के मुसलमान जो है उनका कत्लेआम हुआ. युवराज ऑब्वियसली ऑब्जेक्टेड टू इट. ही इमीडिएटली रोट बैक टू शेख अब्दुल्ला. शेख अब्दुल्ला डिड नॉट रिप्लाई. Yuvraj also brought the cuttings of Tribune and Hindustan Times that had reported that speech of Panthal and sent it to Jawaharlal Nehru. Now Jawaharlal Nehru was in a very difficult situation. So he somehow pacified Yuvraj also. And then he suggested that he will talk to Sheikh Abdullah, but in the meantime, he will look for some advisor to the Yuvraj, through whom the Yuvraj can convey his ideas to Sheikh Abdullah, and Sheikh Abdullah can convey through him to Yuvraj, so that there is no misunderstanding. He said that even he has the same arrangement with Dr. Rajendra Prasad, the President of India. So that was okay. But the problem was that bad blood had already started flowing. Maharaja consulted some lawyers in Bombay. I think the Kanga and the brothers, that was the name of the law firm. And they advised that legally, since he was still the Maharaja, therefore the proclamation must be issued under his name. And he should convene the assembly. And he should set the agenda for the assembly. The assembly, after having met, discussed, should report back to the Maharaja what its views are. And then the constitution should be adopted. Before that, Maharaja will send it to the Parliament of India for approval of the agenda. Now, this was something which the government of India did not want. They did not want Maharaja to be involved in this whole process, because they suspected that he will create some problems. So ultimately, when he insisted that he should do it, then Iyengar wrote a very blunt letter to him, telling him that he should lift the ban on Yuvraj Karan Singh regarding the signing of the proclamation, because the assembly will be convened with or without anybody's signature. In other words, it was the ultimatum that you allow Yuvraj to sign the proclamation. Otherwise, the assembly will be convened by Sheikh Abdullah. And after that, neither you nor Karan Singh will have any role to play in public life. Now, obviously, this was a serious matter. Maharaja Hari Singh also understood the message, and he lifted the embargo on Yuvraj Karan Singh, telling him that he should use his own discretion and he was free to sign it. So he did sign it. The assembly did meet, and again the meanness of Sheikh Abdullah comes through it. The assembly has been convened under the signature of Yuvraj Karan Singh, the regent. But he was not allowed to make the opening address to that assembly. A person who convenes an assembly, it is his prerogative to address that assembly. But Yuvraj was not given that privilege. Sheikh Abdullah appropriated that right also. He put before the assembly three main issues First was obviously the accession. The second was landfalls. And the third was the future of the dynasty in a republic. Now, it is very interesting that normally what happens is that a constitution is discussed, each and every article is discussed, adopted, and finally, the whole document is presented to the assembly once again for voting. This was not done. Sheikh Abdullah wanted these three subjects to be out of his way. The rest of the constitution can come in due course. Since we are almost about an hour into the series today, I will briefly sum up and then pick up the thread again during the second part. And that is that he made a very grand announcement. It pleased, it gladdened the heart of the whole of India. When he said that Kashmir has acceded to India. And he gave the reasons that though logically Kashmiris should be going to Pakistan because of religion, because of culture, because all the rivers of Kashmir go through Pakistan. The roads, the links, all go through Pakistan. But yet, Pakistan is a communal country. Pakistan is a reactionary country where there is no place for the poor, for the landless, for the laborers, for the farmers. And therefore, we will pitch our fate along with India, which is secular, which is socialist, which is liberal. Second was land reform. Land reform, in fact, they had already taken place. It was only a seal of approval that was to be put on it. And the third was the future of the dynasty. I'll pick up the thread again from this point, the future of the dynasty, when we meet again the next time. And now I would be very happy to take any questions and also be educated if somebody has a comment to educate me on this subject. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Harbans sir. Anybody in the audience would like to ask any questions? Koi bhi agar is topic ko lekar sawal ho, to please aap pooch sakte hain.
Hello, can you hear me please?
Yes, Jagmohan sir, we can hear you.
Anji, I'm Jagmohan Sharma. काफी अच्छा इंटरेक्शन और काफी नॉलेज है संभल साहब की, लेकिन मेरे को एक ही जो सिचुएशन रहती है, बिकॉज आई एम लिविंग इन जम्मू एट द मोमेंट, आई बिलोंग टू दिस प्लेस, तो हिस्ट्री में तो काफी कुछ है जिसमें जम्मू वालों को हमेशा ही धोखा दिया गया है, लेकिन हम लोग एक ऐसी स्थिति में हैं जिसमें हम उस हिस्ट्री से कुछ सीख नहीं रहे. मेरे विचार से संभ्याल साहब भी जम्मू में ही हैं, if I'm not mistaken.
No, I belong to Jammu, but I'm not in Jammu. I'm Chandigarh.
तो चंडीगढ़. So मेरा कहना ये है कि जो कश्मीर की पॉलिटिक्स है या कश्मीर के पॉलिटिशियन है, कौन सा समय है जब उन्होंने डोगरा या जम्मू जो प्रोविंस है इसको धोखा नहीं दिया? जब क्विट इंडिया मूवमेंट शुरू हुई तो जो शेख साहब की उसमें स्पीच थी वो कहते हैं, टायरनी ऑफ डोगरास हैज लैकेटेड अवर सोल, इट इज टाइम फॉर एक्शन, यू मस्ट फाइट स्लेवरी एंड एंटर द फील्ड ऑफ जिहाद एज सोल्जर्स, एवरी मैन वुमन एंड चाइल्ड शैल शाउट क्विट कश्मीर, द कश्मीरी नेशन हैज एक्सप्रेस्ड इट्स विल, आई आस्क फॉर प्लेबिसाइड ऑन दिस क्वेश्चन. एंड ये बात है 1946 मई की। सो प्लेबिसाइट कहीं ना कहीं उस समय भी शेख अब्दुल्ला के दिमाग में था 1946 मई में, क्योंकि वो क्विट कश्मीर की बात कर रहा है। जिस समय वो क्विट कश्मीर की बात कर रहा था, वो क्विट जम्मू की बात तो नहीं कर रहा था, और क्विट जम्मू की बात नहीं कर रहा था, लेकिन हम लोगों ने किसी ना किसी प्रकार से जम्मू से क्विट करना आस्ते आस्ते शुरू कर दिया, इमिडिएटली आफ्टर 1947, 48, 49, वट एवर यू से। और अभी भी हम लोग ये नहीं समझ पा रहे कि हम लोग कैसे इकट्ठे हों सो दैट ये जो कश्मीरी पॉलिटिक्स है, इससे हमको निजात मिले या हम इससे फ्री हो पाए। तो सर, मेरी एक बड़ी सिंपल सी सबमिशन है आप लोगों से, सब जो इसमें हैं, इंटरनेशनल डोगरा सोसाइटी से, कि जो हिस्ट्री में हो गया वो तो हो गया, हम आगे कैसे बढ़े सो दैट वी आर एट सम पॉइंट इन टाइम वी आर एबल टू हैव अ स्टेट ऑफ जम्मू वेयर वी डोंट एवरी डे हैव टू लुक टूवर्ड्स कश्मीरीज फॉर देयर बेनिवोलेंस। आज ही आप देखेंगे कई सारी अपॉइंटमेंट्स हुई हैं इन फायर सर्विसेज और समथिंग, जिसमें 300 कुछ पोजीशंस थी, जिसमें से सिर्फ 50-60 जो हैं वो जम्मू वालों को मिली हैं, रेस्ट एवरीथिंग हैज गॉन टू कश्मीर। अब ये मेरा कहना है सर सम्याल साहब एंड अदर्स, ये एक सिचुएशन ऐसी है जिस सिचुएशन में से हमको निकलना है, और इस सिचुएशन में से निकलने के लिए जम्मू स्टेट जब तक बनेगी नहीं तब तक कोई इसका सोल्यूशन नहीं है। तो इसमें हम लोग कैसे मूव करें सर? हिस्ट्री में सर्टेनली मैं तो हैट्स ऑफ टू यू, आपकी मैंने पुस्तक भी पढ़ी हुई है, इंसिडेंटली मैं भी चंडीगढ़ में पार्टली रहता हूँ, सो दैट इज वेयर आई गॉट योर बुक, जो इंग्लिश बुक शॉप है वहां से, दैट इज वेयर आई फाउंड इट। बट द पॉइंट रिमेन्स कि हम लोग यूनाइटेड कैसे हों, हम लोग इकट्ठे होके किस तरह से एक ऐसी मूवमेंट चालू करें ताकि जम्मू जो है वो उस मुसीबत से अलग हो। ये देखिए ना, योर सोल ही सेज कि आवर सोल हैज बीन लैकरेटेड बाय द डोगरास। इससे ज्यादा मतलब क्या लैंग्वेज हो सकती है 1946 में? तो ये मेरी समीशन है सर कि हिस्ट्री से हम लेसन सीखें और अपने आप को स्ट्रेंथन करें, क्योंकि जम्मू में मैं जो देख रहा हूँ यहाँ पे हर किस्म की डिविजन्स हैं, कश्मीरीज ऑल एंड ऑल सेड एंड डन दे आर टुगेदर ऑन वन पोजिशन। और मैं बिल्कुल क्लैरिटी के साथ कहता हूँ, मुझे ये कहने में कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं है कि दे ऑल हैव ग्रीन कलर, ओनली द शेड डिफर्स। और शेड भी कैसे डिफर करता है, फॉर सम ऑफ देम द शेड इज लाइट व्हेन दे आर इन गवर्नमेंट, एंड व्हेन दे आर आउटसाइड द गवर्नमेंट देयर शेड इज मोर ग्रीन, आई मीन डेंस ग्रीन और व्हाटएवर यू कॉल इट। और जम्मू एक ऐसी जगह है विच इज द ओनली सेक्युलर एरिया इन द प्रोबेबली इन द नॉर्थ ऑफ इंडिया। यहाँ गुज्जर बकरवाल हिंदू मुस्लिम सिख क्रिश्चियन बुद्धिस्ट हर किस्म के लोग हैं, 10-10 के करीब यहाँ पे लैंग्वेजेस और डायलेक्ट्स हैं जो बोले जाते हैं, और सारे सेपरेट हैं। आप ये देखिए सर कि तेलंगाना और आंध्र प्रदेश जिनका कल्चर और उनका बैकग्राउंड ऑलमोस्ट सेम है, अगर तेलंगाना स्टेट इसलिए बनी क्योंकि तेलंगाना वालों को एक फीलिंग हुई कि आंध्रा वाले जो लोग हैं, सारे चीफ मिनिस्टर्स इन आंध्र प्रदेश, ऑल ऑफ देम केम प्रैक्टिकली फ्रॉम आंध्र प्रदेश एंड नॉट फ्रॉम तेलंगाना रीजन। जो एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन में से थी कुछ लोगों की, दे वर ऑल फ्रॉम आंध्र प्रदेश, बिजनेसेस जिन लोगों के पास थे दे वर ऑल फ्रॉम आंध्र प्रदेश, और वो बेसिस लेके आंध्रा और तेलंगाना दो स्टेट्स हैं। और जम्मू और कश्मीर के बीच में, एक्सेप्टिंग फॉर रिलीजन पार्ट फॉर सम, अगर रिलीजन को आप अलग कर दें, दे आर कल्चरली डिफरेंट फ्रॉम कश्मीरीज। तो मेरी सबमिशन सबसे यही है, बिकॉज आई हैव बीन रेगुलरली स्पीकिंग ऑन दिस, और इसको मैं यहीं पे कम क्लोज माय दिस थिंग, आई विल क्लोज माय दिस थिंग ऑन दिस, कि इस डायरेक्शन में भी अगर सब लोग मिलकर देखें, आई थिंक इट विल बी अ वेरी बिग हेल्प टू द जमुईट्स, जम्मू एज ए रीजन, नॉट एज ए रिलीजन और एनीथिंग एल्स, एज ए रीजन। थैंक यू, थैंक
I
यू वेरी
think
मच।
there is some problem with the network.
Your voice is breaking, Harbans sir. Hello, Harbans sir. It looks like it's better. Yes, you're back. You want to speak now?
Yes. Number one, Sharma ji, I am I apologize because even if I have an opinion on this subject, I will refrain from giving that opinion at this juncture. मैंने शुरू में कहा कि मैं किसी पॉलिटिकल पार्टी को बिलोंग नहीं करता, मैं कोई पॉलिटिकल स्टेटमेंट जो है अपनी तरफ से मैं कोई नहीं देना चाहता, लेकिन मैं बड़ा क्लियर हूं कुछ मामलों में, जम्मू और कश्मीर के मामले में, इसके फेट के मामले में आई एम एज वरीड एज यू आर. आई मे नॉट बी लिविंग देयर, मैनी ऑफ द पीपल फ्रॉम इंटरनेशनल डोगरा सोसाइटी वो भी वहां नहीं रह रहे होंगे, लेकिन हमारा कंसर्न है जम्मू के साथ, जम्मू के साथ कंसर्न है, इसीलिए हम इस प्रकार मिलते जुलते हैं और आपस में बातें शेयर करते हैं. आफ्टर ऑल हमारे रिश्तेदार नातेदार सब वहीं हैं, उनकी फेट जो है उससे हम भी किसी न किसी तरीके से जो है वो जुड़े हुए हैं. एंड इट इज वेरी अनफॉर्चुनेट, ये फैक्ट है. इफ यू हैव रेड माई बुक, आई एम वेरी क्लियर इन माई बुक के जो है who is to be held responsible, who is guilty, and how unfair and malicious was the Quit India movement. I have already expressed that view. As far as the statehood is concerned, that is for the political parties to come together and think. If the political parties ask me that what is your opinion, I can give my opinion. And that's about it. Apart from that, there can be no contribution from my side because I am not a political activist as such. I am fully occupied with my writing work, with my reading work, and I'm very happy doing that. And I'm more happy because I know that many people, they respond to what I write and what I say. That gives me great satisfaction. It is for them to read that, to listen to what I have already said or I say, and then conclude according to their own judgment. I will never try to influence them. But yes, there is injustice, and that injustice has to be righted. There is no doubt about that.
And I'm also not from any political party, incidentally. I don't belong to any political
party. So we are in the same boat.
But yes, then wherever a question of framing the opinion or pushing an opinion is concerned, I think that is what, in a very small, minuscule way, I am not a like somebody who can do it, but in a very small, minuscule way, I certainly do it. You can see it on Twitter or wherever. I am as blunt as anything on that. But the point remains, this is what it is. If we don't, because I'll tell you, sir, 2 years back, there were not many people from Jammu on Twitter. But today it is really, wonderful that there are so many people. They might not be working in cohesion or they might be speaking in different languages, but certainly, yes, they are on Twitter and they have an opinion.
Yes.
So that
yes.
certainly gives an encouragement, because I've been on Twitter for more than 9 years, but I didn't find many people from Jammu, but yes, now they are there and it's really encouraging.
So they are using power of Twitter. So now they are using power of Twitter.
Yeah, a lot of voices have come from Jammu now. Things are changing. I see younger generation thinking on the same terms. I think one of my opinion which comes, and not opinion, what I can say is from your talk is, what we see is we have a lot of politicians, but we don't have a great leader from Jammu. I think it's time for Jammu to produce a good leader. And once we have a good leader, I think things can change. So I think leadership is very necessary, right?
Actually, if you look at it, Jammu never had a leader. Jammu didn't have a leader since 1931. Everybody was banking on the Maharaja. But Maharaja had his own limitations because the way things were moving, as Sambyal sir, वो ना जाने अनजाने में भी मैं इनको अपना गुरु मानता हूँ, because that is where I read so many things, whatever he has written. But the it is like Ekalavya's case, but the point remains that leadership was never there. But when people start talking together, I give an example if you have time. Like, for example, on Friday, all these people go for prayers, so even God starts listening to them. But in a similar manner, if people start thinking in a particular way, there is always a possibility that something might come up.
Yes.
Possible. Let's hope for the best.
Yes. And before we go any further, any other person would like to add or ask any question? Cool. Okay, then on that note, we will bring today's session to an end. Thank you everybody for joining us, and thank you Harbhajan Singh Sambhyalji. We will meet again for the second session, part two.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Lalit ji, Dogras ko sirf yahan pe Jammu mein resentment mein hi rehna padega, because they are in...
I think General Saab wants to say something.
Namaskar, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
And Harbhajan ji.
Yes, sir.
Wonderful. I think it's an eye opener.
Thank you very much.
Actually, I don't know how we can arrange these talks, although you have written some parts in the books, but like this, people should know this work, what research you have done should have been done in my Jammu University. But I don't think they have done anything, and I don't know whether they even are listening this. Anyway, I will send copies of this to these universities and ask them, go and do research on this.
Yes, sir. Sir, I'll share the YouTube link with you once after this session. You can share those.
These are the facts, unfortunately, were not known to the people. That's why they were all misled, and they never knew what they were. That's why what we call distortion or Dogra history is distorted. What Harbhajan ji has brought out today, this is all not known to us. That is, it's distortion. Not studied, it is also distortion. So things should improve, and they will only improve once we have Jammu state. With Kashmir state plugged with us, we will have nothing. We will not live better. In fact, we will be much worse now. Sometime in Ladakh was with us, at least they used to cry for us also. Now they have gone, they are happy. And the Kashmiris, the moment they get this back their power, Jammu will be completely off the scene. And then, I don't know, I hope the government of India also does not see the way they were seeing before. What Sharma ji is saying, that is the only answer. I don't know. My problem is how to wake up the Jammu leadership. They're all sleeping. Where are the parties? They keep on fighting among themselves. Why don't they fight for Jammu? Why should they fight between themselves? They should fight for Jammu. That is very unfortunate. And Dogra is a good soldier. And I thought he was a good fighter. But he's too poor a politician. Where are those bombastic words we hear? No, where none is speaking for the last 2 years. I have not seen. Where have they gone themselves? I don't see them anywhere today. That's very unfortunate part. So, but Harbhajan ji, I think much more and more should be known. I must put it. And Lalit ji, good thing you are organizing this. Keep doing this. We should, I think, whatever Harbhajan ji has given today, we must carry it forward.
Sure, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
General Saab.
Anji.
You'll be glad to know that one of my friends, he suggested ki bhai ye lecture jo hai na, inko book form mein nikalo.
Bilkul, bilkul.
Very good.
So bilkul. I do intend, after the series is over.
Definitely. Ye bachon ke liye bhi.
Nahin, I can see there are many more things. Many more things are going to come from you, I am expecting. No, I tell you honestly, this is what we've been looking for the last, and probably I'm living only for such things to happen in the next few years. People should be educated. Now is the time to educate, but unfortunately, Dogras are not even wanting to get educated. क्या करें? इसका कोई इलाज नहीं हो रहा. बहुत ट्विटर भी, ये ग्रुप्स भी बहुत बनाए हैं, पूरे टाइम लगा देते हैं. शर्मा जी ठीक कह रहे हैं, यूथ को भी काफी बताया, पर अभी यूथ इज नॉट स्टिल अंडरस्टैंडिंग व्हाट आर द रियल इश्यूज, व्हाट आर द रियल प्रॉब्लम्स, बिकॉज पॉलिटिकली वी हैव नेवर बीन अवेकन्ड. इवन अभी तक सोए हुए हैं हम जम्मू वाले, अभी आज तक भी 73 years have passed. That's why we are suffering. Nobody bothers about Jammu. Jammu के problem वैसे के वैसे ही हैं. दो साल से भी कोई problem हल नहीं हुआ हमारा. But ultimately, history, everything will depend on politics. If we have our Dogras have their own rule, then these books will come. Indian history has been completely ruined. अभी निकाल रहे हैं, थोड़ी थोड़ी जब निकालते हैं तो फिर problem हो जाता है. It's all political because it's all politics. You are right, but politics has to be also corrected before we correct our history. That's what problem really is today in Jammu. Jammu problem is a political problem. You absolutely correct. And until we have a Jammu state separate, we will not be able to correct our things. That is a final word as far as I can say. Thank you. Wonderful. Very nice effort and very good initiative, and we should carry this forward.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Anyone else would like to say anything? I think Nidhi ji, aap kuch bol rahe the?
Main sir ko namaskar karna chahti hu aur chahungi inse aashirwad lena. Iske baad main baat karungi inse. Sir, mere theek hai.
जी,
और ये बोलूंगे डोगरा, जम्मू का डोगरा इज स्टिल लिविंग इन रिजेंटमेंट. उनको पता ही नहीं है क्या बोलना है, किसको बोलना है, उनकी प्रॉब्लम क्या है. बस चली जा रहे हैं, चली जा रहे हैं, और कानून इनके ऊपर थोपे जा रहे हैं और वो सिर झुका के इनको कबूल करे जा रहे
हैं. ये है निधि जी, लीडर का काम क्यों होता, लीडर का काम होता लोगों का व्यू जरा उन्हें एक्सप्रेस करना.
जी
सर, लीडर तक पूछ ही नहीं पाने ना, प्रॉब्लम ये वादी है,
पॉलिटिशियंस पे ही रह जाते.
जवाब आता रिजेक्शन बिलकुल, लेकिन अज का करंट इशू तो यो है ना, जो जम्मू को बहर रवा दे, जम्मू वापिस अपने लियन कने जुड़ना ना.
डोमिसाइल तो सिर्फ एक एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव प्रॉब्लम है, वो कल की सॉल्व भी हो सकती है, लेकिन द इशू इज समथिंग एल्स.
या ऑफ कोर्स सर, आई एग्री, आई टोटली एग्री विद यू. चला गया ये क्या.
ओके, थैंक यू एवरीबॉडी, वी विल मीट अगेन ऑन पार्ट 2 ऑफ द सेम टॉपिक वेरी सून. थैंक यू.
थैंक यू.
Oh, very well done.